Good morning. Today we are going to continue our review of rotational dynamics as part of the AP Physics C mechanics curriculum.
Flippin' physics!
Bo, you wanted to talk about this last time, so here's your chance. What is the equation for torque, which includes the cross product?
Torque equals the cross product of F and R.
Actually, torque is the cross product of R and F.
Does the order of R and F really matter?
Well, yes, the cross product is not commutative.
Of course it's not.
And we should also point out that R is the position vector from the axis of rotation to where on the object the force is applied.
And remember, cross product is the area of the parallelogram created by those two vectors. For torque, it is the area with the sides R and F that create the parallelogram. And the magnitude of the torque is R times F times the sine of the angle theta, which is the angle between the direction of R and the direction of the force. And now let's do a basic example to review cross product with unit vectors. Vector A is negative I plus j minus 2k. Vector B is 2i minus 3j plus 4k. Billy, please work out A cross B.
Well, the cross product is the determinant of a matrix. This time, because we have three dimensions, x, y, and z, we have a 3x3 matrix. So the cross product is the determinant of the matrix where the first row is I, j, k. The second row is the components of A, or negative 1, 1, negative 2. And the third row is the components of B, or 2, negative 3, 4. That is equal to the sum of the 2x2 determinants for each of the unit vectors, although we subtract the second determinant, the determinant that goes with J in this case. So cross out the row and column which has I in it, and you get the determinant 1, negative 2, negative 3, 4 times unit vector I. Cross out the row and column which has J in it and subtract the determinant negative 1, negative 2, 2, 4 times unit vector J. Cross out the row and column which has K in it and add the determinant negative 1, 1, 2, negative 3 times unit vector K.
Mr. P, can we skip this step?
Bo, I don't normally write out the step with the 2x2 determinants in it. However, I think it's a good idea this time to have done this to see where the next step comes from. Billy?
Now we multiply 1 by 4 and subtract the product of negative 2 and negative 3 and multiply that quantity by unit vector I. Then we subtract the quantity negative 1 times 4 minus the product of negative 2 and 2, all that times unit vector j. And we add the product of negative 1 and negative 3 and subtract 1 times 2, all times unit vector k. That works out to be the quantity 4 minus 6 times I minus the quantity negative 4 plus 4 times J plus the quantity 3 minus 2 times K. And actually, all that we're left with is negative 2I plus K.
Thank you, Billy. Bobby, please tell me about translational equilibrium.
Well, we just talked about this during our dynamics review. An object is in translational equilibrium if the net force acting on the object equals zero. And because net force equals mass times acceleration, that means the object is not accelerating.
Very good. And now, Bobby, please extend that to rotational equilibrium.
Okay, then an object is in rotational equilibrium when the net torque acting on the object equals zero. This means because net torque equals moment of inertia times angular acceleration, that the object has no angular acceleration, so the object is either rotating with a constant angular velocity or is not rotating at all.
Now, please remember, when you know an object is in translational equilibrium and rotational equilibrium about one axis of rotation, then you also know that object is also in rotational equilibrium about any other axis of rotation. Which is why, for example, when we look at a person standing on a ladder, we can sum the forces in the x and y directions, and we can also sum the torques about multiple axes of rotation. Capital L stands for angular momentum, and angular momentum is a vector. In order to understand how angular momentum is related to torque, we are going to start with Newton's second law. Net force equals mass times acceleration is the linear form, and net torque equals moment of inertia times angular acceleration is the rotational form. However, neither of those two use derivatives. Net force equals the derivative of linear momentum with respect to time is the linear form of Newton's second law. And net torque equals the derivative of angular momentum with respect to time is the rotational form of Newton's second law, where, of course, torque and angular momentum are vectors. Bo, what is the equation for the angular momentum of a particle?
How can a particle have angular momentum?
Any particle moving relative to an axis of rotation can have angular momentum.
Yeah, that's right. It does not even have to be a particle. Any object which is moving relative to an axis of rotation can have angular momentum.
Bobby and Billy, you guys are correct. And Bo, we'll do an example at the end which shows how a particle can have angular momentum. Billy, why don't you take this one? What is the equation for the angular momentum of a particle?
The angular momentum for a particle or a rigid object which is moving but not rotating equals the cross product of R and momentum. And R is similar to what it is in the torque equation. R is the position vector from the location of the center of mass of the moving object to the axis of rotation.
Then the angular momentum equals R cross mass times velocity, or R times mass times velocity times the sine of the angle between the directions of R and velocity.
But that is just the magnitude of the angular momentum. The cross product equation is a vector and includes direction. If we use that last equation, we have to use the right-hand rule to find the direction of torque, just like we did in our last review. Right, Mr. P?
That is correct, Bobby. And Bobby, what is the equation for the angular momentum of a rigid object with shape which is rotating around an axis of rotation?
A rigid object with shape has an angular momentum which equals the moment of inertia of that object times that object's angular velocity.
And the units for angular momentum are kilograms times meters squared for moment of inertia times radians per second for angular velocity.
But radians are dimensionless and just a placeholder. Therefore, the units for angular momentum are kilogram meters squared per second.
The derivation of the conservation of linear momentum of a system is: if the net external force acting on the system equals zero, then the derivative of the momentum of the system with respect to time is equal to zero. That means the momentum of the system is not changing as a function of time, and that is conservation of linear momentum. We could do the same thing to derive conservation of angular momentum. If the net external torque acting on the system is equal to zero, then the derivative of the angular momentum of the system with respect to time is equal to zero. Therefore, the angular momentum of the system is not changing as a function of time. This is conservation of angular momentum. One important difference to remember here is that torque and angular momentum are relative to an axis of rotation. In other words, whenever you use conservation of angular momentum, you have to identify your axis of rotation. Okay, let's now do an example problem which reviews conservation of angular momentum because we have to. Bobby, could you please read the problem? And Bo, could you please translate?
A piece of gum with mass m and velocity v is spat at a solid cylinder of mass m, radius r, and moment of inertia 1/2 mr squared. The cylinder is on a horizontal axis through its center of mass and is initially at rest.
Stop. Knowns for the gum are mass, little m, and velocity initial, little v. The knowns for the cylinder are mass, big m, radius, big r, moment of inertia, which is 1/2 big mass times big radius squared, and the cylinder has no initial angular velocity.
Okay, so I dislike using a lowercase m for the mass of one object and an uppercase m for the mass of a different object. I know the AP writers like to do that sometimes. However, to me, it just obfuscates what the masses really represent. So what I'm going to use is m sub g for the mass of the gum, v sub gi for the velocity of the gum initial, m sub c for the mass of the cylinder, and I'll just use capital R for the radius of the cylinder because it's the only object that has a radius. And I do suggest that you do this, you clarify your variables when you're solving an AP problem so that you can help the AP graders understand what you're doing, which is always good. Bobby?
The line of action of the gum is located horizontally a height y above the axis of the cylinder. If the gum sticks to the cylinder, what is the final angular velocity of the gum cylinder system?
Angular velocity final, which will be the same for both the gum and the cylinder, equals question mark. However, I don't really know what to do with y.
It's okay, Bo. It's actually a lot easier to describe using a drawing. Notice because the gum sticks to the cylinder that we know y must be less than the radius, capital R, of the cylinder. Now, I know I said this was a conservation of angular momentum problem. However, can anyone explain to me how we know angular momentum is conserved in this example?
Angular momentum is conserved in a system when the net external torque acting on the system equals zero.
When the gum hits the cylinder, there is a force on the gum from the cylinder, which is directed radially outward.
And because of Newton's third law, there is an equal but opposite force acting on the cylinder from the gum, which is directed radially inward.
And if we sum the torques around the axis of rotation of the cylinder, the torques from both of those forces are zero, and therefore the net external torque acting on the system equals zero. And angular momentum about the axis of rotation of the cylinder is conserved.
Now let's solve the problem. Billy, could you please?
Absolutely. Conservation of angular momentum equals the initial angular momentum of the gum plus the initial angular momentum of the cylinder, and that equals the final angular momentum of the gum plus the final angular momentum of the cylinder. The gum is a particle, so we use the equation R for the gum initial times the mass of the gum times the velocity of the gum initial times the sine of theta for the gum initial. The cylinder is not rotating initially, so it has no initial angular momentum. The gum is still a particle after the collision, so we use the same equation, only substitute in final instead of initial. The cylinder is a rotating object with shape after the collision, so we use the moment of inertia of the cylinder times the final angular velocity of the cylinder. But I don't really know what to do from here.
This is where we need to find a relationship between R for the gum initial, theta for the gum initial, and this value y. The issue is that both the R for the gum initial and theta for the gum initial are changing as a function of time as the gum approaches the cylinder. The way we deal with this is we take the sine of theta for the gum initial, which equals opposite over hypotenuse. Opposite theta is this value y, and on the hypotenuse is R for the gum initial. And we could solve for y, it equals R for the gum initial times the sine of theta for the gum initial. So while R for the gum initial and theta for the gum initial both change as a function of position as that gum approaches the cylinder, the value y, which equals R for the gum initial times the sine of theta for the gum initial, is a constant. Y does not change as the gum approaches the cylinder. So we replace R for the gum initial times the sine of theta for the gum initial with the value y. Just so you know, this concept of replacing R times sine theta with a constant value is pretty much guaranteed to come up on the AP exam. Bobby, what about the final values?
The final equation for the gum is the same as the initial, only replacing initial with final, so it should work out to be the same thing, right?
I don't think so. Before the collision, the gum was moving linearly, and after it is moving in circular motion. So the equation is not going to work out the same way.
Okay, so because the gum is moving in a circle, the R final for the gum is the radius of the cylinder, and the velocity final for the gum is a tangential velocity, which we know equals radius times angular velocity, so we can substitute the radius of the cylinder times the final angular velocity for the final velocity of the gum.
And theta for the gum final will be 90 degrees because tangential velocity is always tangent to the radius, and the sine of 90 degrees is 1.
And we can substitute 1/2 times the mass of the cylinder times the radius of the cylinder squared for the moment of inertia of the cylinder.
All we need to do now is factor out radius squared times angular velocity final, and then divide by everything on the right-hand side, which is not angular velocity final, and we have the angular velocity final equals y times the mass of the gum times the velocity of the gum initial, all divided by the radius of the cylinder squared times the quantity, the mass of the gum, plus the mass of the cylinder divided by 2.
Now, when getting an answer like this, which is all variables, which is often going to happen on the AP Physics C exam, it's good to just check your equation to make sure it makes logical sense. For example, Billy, does it make logical sense that a larger velocity of the gum initial will result in a larger final angular velocity of the system?
Yeah, it makes sense to me that a larger initial velocity of the gum would increase the final angular velocity of the system. How about this? According to our answer, a larger mass of the cylinder will decrease the final angular velocity of the system. That also makes sense to me.
And a larger radius of the cylinder should decrease the final angular velocity of the system. That's logical. I think I get it.
That is a good exercise to go through whenever you get an answer, which is all variables. That brings us to the end of my review of rotational dynamics. Next, you can enjoy my linear versus rotational review, or you can visit my AP Physics C review webpage. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.